it's time. In this video, we will discuss possible exploit strategies for sudo. In the past 8 episodes, we have used fuzzing to rediscover the crash in sudoedit. We have analyzed the crash with address sanitizer and found the loop that causes a memory corruption. And then we looked at the root cause in detail. And now it's time to make a plan for exploitation. How can we turn this memory corruption in sudo into an actual privilege escalation exploit? Let's head in. For heap exploitation, there are basically 2 strategies. First, you can exploit the heap implementation itself, so attacking the heap metadata, or you can attack the data stored in the heap. Let's think about exploiting the heap metadata first. If you have watched my exploit education playlist, then you might remember the videos about heap exploitation. The heap is basically a data structure with metadata. You can imagine it as a linked list. And this metadata, for example, contains the size of the chunk and some flags, like if the previous chunk is in use or not, blah, blah. Details unimportant right now. And in those old videos, we exploited a very old allocation algorithm called DL-malloc. Not gonna lie, that heap exploitation of DL-malloc was mind-bending and it is complex. But it also didn't have any mitigations, thus it was relatively simple. Nowadays, the default malloc algorithm is a bit more advanced. We have, for example, fastbins, which are different data structure additionally to the regular heap that you might know. And the malloc algorithms also have gotten a bit more hardened, but only in some ways. For example, some techniques with fastbins are actually a lot simpler. But generally, in order to exploit the heap implementation directly, you need a specific order of memory allocations and free operations. So in CTF challenges, you often have some kind of menu where you can create or delete stuff, and then you can perform the exact order of mallocs and frees you need. But in our sudo vulnerability, we have a single shot overflow on the heap. We don't have any interaction with the program. And on top of that, we have to deal with ASLR. And the typical way of dealing with ASLR is to only deal with relative offsets, or first have a bug to leak addresses, thus defeat ASLR, and then you can go further. But again, we don't have any interaction with sudo. We can't perform multiple overflows. We can't really decide how we want to allocate or free chunks. With our one overflow, we need to win. That's why I believe attacking the heap directly, the heap algorithm, the heap metadata is unrealistic. I don't want to say it's impossible. People always find crazy creative ways, but I don't know any reasonable technique that we could try. So that's why I want to go for the second strategy, attacking data on the heap. We have a heap overflow and we can overwrite arbitrary data in other chunks. And we don't immediately crash when we overwrite this data. We crash because of the side effects after we overwrote other data. We call this corrupting memory. So maybe there's some very interesting and useful data stored after our buffer that we can overwrite. As an example, if we find a function pointer on the heap after our chunk and it's then used afterwards, we could overwrite it. And when the function pointer is then used, at least we would have control over the instruction pointer. ASLR would still be an issue, but we could maybe do a partial overwrite. Whatever, future problems, something like that would get us a huge step forward. But how can we find something like that? What do we need to make this work? Let's look at the heap again with heap chunks in GDB. Here's our buffer. Now, how could we know what is stored after it? What is the meaning of this data? How could we know if there is a function pointer? That's not easy. And maybe there is no function pointer here at all. But that's not the only question we should investigate. Check out this. The allocation of our buffer happened right before we caused the overflow. So it's the last chunk that was allocated. But our buffer is not at the end of the heap. This means that during the execution of this program, memory was allocated and freed many times, and there was a hole in the middle where our new buffer could fit in. This means, depending on the size of our buffer, we could end up in different places. To rephrase this, depending on the length of the arguments, so the size we allocate, we might have a different heap chunk after the buffer we can overflow. But that's not all we have to research. We have no clue what influences the sizes of other heap chunks. If you casually scroll through the allocated chunks, here's a chunk with the folder path, and here's what looks like environment variables. Which means, if you have a different set of environment variables, and probably many other things that influence what sizes of chunks are allocated on a heap, the hole where our buffer will be allocated might be in completely different places. The whole heap could be arranged very differently if you control this other data. What does this mean? Does this make it easier or harder? On one hand, this means we might be able to carefully control where we want to place our buffer and override the right thing. On the other hand, it might not work on other systems. Either way, we gotta try. And by the way, this careful planning and arrangement of heap chunks is called heap feng shui. Feng shui is a pseudoscience where you use the energy forces to harmonize individuals with their surrounding environment, or in other words, the pretty arrangements of objects in a room. And I think there is no better word that could describe this for heap exploitation. Harmonize the heap chunks perfectly so that our exploit can work. It's kind of magical. Anyway, I'm not a pwn expert. To be honest, I rarely solve pwnable CTF challenges. I know many won't believe me because I made the binary exploitation series. I must be an expert and do that all the time, but that's not true. This pseudo exploit feels a bit out of my league. I think I have the skills to attempt it. I have some ideas I want to try, but maybe I will fail. And that's totally fine for me, because I know by trying this, I will learn a lot. Actually, I have already learned so many new things working through this project, and it is already a success for me. Remember, other people have done the research and there are many good exploits already. But that's not the point. We use the pseudo vulnerability to learn. And it's cool that others have written exploits already, because if we get stuck or if I get stuck, I can always look at the other exploits for inspiration. So either way, huge success for me. That being said, what should be our next steps? I have two ideas I want to combine. The first idea is to write a tool that helps us enumerate or fuzz different heap configurations by controlling buffer sizes. But to be honest, this idea is not actually from me. When PseudoEdit was released, I obviously read over the advisory and I remember them saying this. To implement this initial technique, we wrote a rudimentary brute forcer that executes sudo inside of GDB, overflows the user args buffer and randomly selects the following parameters. So this is an example of where I read about an idea, it seemed obvious and I saved it in my head, and facing this exploitation challenge, I recalled that I could try to brute force different parameters. Now, the advisory specifically talks about which parameters they fuzz because they have an actual exploit technique they are going for, but for my learning attempt, I don't want to do that. I don't know this technique, so I want to see if I can figure something out myself, but still using the technique of brute forcing heap layouts. That was the first idea, but I have a second idea. I thought I could specifically search through the heap for function pointers. How would I do that? I'm sorry not telling you just now, but I would love to hear your ideas in the comments below. Next video, I show you how I have done it.